This video will explain how an object-oriented middleware can work, how it is possible to create such a thing that enables calling a method in an object in another network node. So to start with, let's assume that we have two processes. So this cloudy thing in the middle is, as usual, the network. Then we have written a caller, an object that is supposed to call some other object that resides in one node. And in the other node, we have written another object, the callee, that will be called by the caller. Now, the caller is supposed to call a method in the callee. Say that this is the chat program. So here is the method send that is supposed to send the message to all other nodes. Takes a string. And on the client side, we have the caller object that is supposed to call the callee. And we want the caller to be able to contain code just like callee.send and some string, just as if it had been a local object. So this is the setup. This is what we want to achieve. So typical way to solve this in an object-oriented middleware is to write an interface. So it's a requirement to use the middleware that the developer also writes an interface defining the method that can be called remotely. In this case, this is the send method. Things we have written for the client side are blue. The things we have written for the server side, the callee side, are black. And the things we write that will exist on both sides will be green. So that's the interface. So now let's write the interface. Okay, so the interface will exist both on the client and server side. How to distribute it to both ends is really up to the developer, but I will talk about that later. So I named the interface callee def as in definition, and changed the name of the class to callee impl as in implementation, implementing the interface. And remember, this dashed line means implements. Okay, and the method send is defined in the interface and of course must be implemented in the class. Now I have written the callee def interface also on the client side here. And of course it has the method send also on the client side. It's the same interface. So this is our code. Then there will be a thing in yellow as well, existing both on client and server side, which is the object-oriented middleware. In the case of Java, the yellow code is part of the JDK. It's the Java RMI remote method invocation framework that is part of the JDK. So we just have to import those packages and use it. So in order to be able to use the object-oriented middleware, we must make it aware of the fact that our code exists. So we must pass an object of the class callee_impl to the object-oriented middleware. So that's up to us, therefore I will make this black. By calling the appropriate method in the object-oriented middleware, we inform the middleware about the fact that this object callee_impl shall be remotely callable, and this to export. So I will write that in yellow, since it's a method in the object-oriented middleware. It can be called anything in different middlewares, but export is a common name. So what will the OOM do when an object is exported? First, it will store a reference to that object. Let's say the OOM keeps an internal table where it keeps references to exported objects. So here's a reference to the exported object. And let's say it's indexed by an ID. Let's say the OOM creates an ID for each exported object. Okay, so it maintains such a table. It knows about this object. Then the OOM will also create a new object, which will in fact also implement the callee def interface. This new object will contain the ID of the exported object, and it will contain the host, for example the IP address, of this callee node where the callee is residing. I said that this object was created by the object-oriented middleware. How can it create such a thing? The object-oriented middleware does not know that there exists an interface called callee def. How can that be implemented? Okay, there are various ways in different OOMs, but the typical solution is that the OOM reads the class file of the exported object, this callee_impl, and then it will see that this object implements the callee def interface, and then the object-oriented middleware will actually write a class file. Well, it might not be written to disk, but at least internally in the JVM there will exist a class file representing a class that also implements the same interface and of course has the send method. And such an object is often called a stub. Then this object, the stub, can be retrieved by the client. It will be sent over the network to the client. How can the client retrieve this object? I will come back to that later. But first, let's move it to the client side, representing the fact that it has been retrieved by the caller. Now the stub object, which I have named the callee stub, is on the client side, the caller side, and it contains the ID and the host. The ID of the callee object that is kept by the OOM on the callee side, and the host, that is the IP address of the callee node. And of course it has the send method, since it implements the callee def interface. Now when the client wants to perform this call, callee send, it will do this call to the interface. Remember I said the caller retrieved the stub from the callee node, but the client will only know about this object as the interface name. Okay, so the client has a reference to the callee def interface, and it does not know what object implements this interface. The caller can actually not know what object was passed. It does not know it was the stub object that arrived at the caller node. So the client cannot see any difference between the callee stub and the callee impl, because they both implement the callee def interface. So the client will then call the method send, but that will now be the method in the callee stub object. So when the client performs this call, the send method in the callee stub executes. And what does that method do? Well, it makes a network call to the callee node. So how can it make this network call? It can make the network call because it has the host of the callee, and the object-oriented middleware keeps a port open. So this is the port. What will be passed? It will pass the ID of the object that was exported. It will pass the method name send, and it will pass all parameters. In this case there is only one MSG. What will the object-oriented middleware on the callee side do when it receives this network call? It will do a lookup of the ID in its table, and then it will read the method name and the method parameters and translate that to a call to this method in that object. How that is done is also different in different RMI middlewares. In Java it's quite easy to call a method if you know the method name. If you have the name of a method in a string, you can call that method. It's called reflection, but I will not go into exactly how that works, but it's quite straightforward. So if there was a return value from the method send, it will be returned, of course, by the callee impl object back to the OOM. The OOM will then pass that return value back to the stub over the same network connection, and the stub can then return that value to the caller. So this is essentially how an object-oriented middleware works. And notice that the application developers only wrote the blue, black and green things, which is only the application specific code performing the actual logic of the application. The OOM provided all the yellow things, which is the actual infrastructure code and all the network handling. So that's very nice. Okay, I also want to mention that this process here of translating what is represented by this blue arrow to what is represented by this yellow arrow, that is, translate the data needed for a method call to a network format, that is called marshalling. So to marshal means to create such a network representation. On the callee side, the corresponding thing happens. The network representation is again translated back to a format that can be used for the method call of the callee impl, and that is called to unmarshal. So the caller and the callee must agree on the network representation. To marshal means to create that network representation, and to unmarshal means to interpret it. And then when this call is made, that is the return value of the method is returned to the callee stub, then it's the callee side that marshals, creates the network representation used here, and the caller side that unmarshals, interprets the network representation here. Some OOMs have another object that is not included here that sits here and performs exactly the unmarshalling of a request and the upcall to the callee and the marshalling of the return value. And such an object is called a skeleton. And I did not write it at first because in Java RMI there is no skeleton, but it's anyway good to know what the concept of a skeleton is. Now we got it. This is the complete object-oriented middleware and how it works. So now I will explain how the caller can get a reference to the callee stub. And the thing is, there is a third node, namely the green one at the bottom, the registry, which is also a node using the object-oriented middleware. So as you can see, the yellow object-oriented middleware appears as previously on the callee node and the caller node, but also on the green registry node. So the green thing here represents the registry. How it started depends on OOM. With Java RMI, you give the command RMI registry at the command prompt, and then the registry will start. And you can also start it programmatically. We can imagine that the registry keeps a hash table. By the way, should not really write OOM there, but rather here, illustrating the fact that it sits between the registry and the network. Okay, so the registry keeps this table, which maps logical names to objects. Let's look at the callee. The startup code, for example main, first creates an instance of the callee. I'll write new. And then step two is to export that new instance to the object-oriented middleware. But then the startup code must do three, which is to make a call through the OOM to the registry and store the callee in the registry. And that is called to bind this call. To where is that directed? Well, as I said, the registry is also a node in the OOM using the same middleware. So on both the caller and callee nodes, there are registry stubs. So both the callee and the caller can make remote method invocations, RMI calls, to the registry using the object-oriented middleware. Okay, first I will explain how the caller and the callee communicates with the registry. Then I will explain from where the registry stubs appeared. So first there is the bind call from the startup code to the registry stub. And the stub, of course, communicates using the OOM over the network to the registry. And in bind, the callee is passed, the newly created callee object. And then the registry will receive the callee and will insert it into its table. I will write C as in callee. And it's bound under some logical name, N. Okay, but let's stop for a while and have a look at this C object. What is actually the C object? It is the stub of the callee. And this is very essential. When an object that has been exported to RMI, the callee, is passed as a parameter in the method call here, it is actually the stub of that object that is passed. So the C here is the stub of the callee. The registry has a reference to the callee stub. Then over to the caller. The startup code of the caller, of course, must create an instance of the caller. Then it must also here call the registry stub, but now to do lookup of the logical name N, the name under which the object was bound in the registry. And now this stub will perform a network call over the object-oriented middleware to the registry, doing a lookup for the logical name N. And the registry then will return the bound object, that is the callee stub. This object will now by the registry be returned in response to the lookup call, and can then be returned by the stub to the startup code or whoever made the lookup call. So that's how the caller got the callee stub. So it was just passing an object, namely the stub object, first from the callee to the registry and then from the registry to the caller. Okay, but haven't we just postponed the problem now? Instead of having one stub whose origin was difficult to explain, we now have two stubs, or at least one stub appearing in two places, the registry stub. How did the caller and the callee obtain the registry stubs? Well, the thing is, the registry is created by the same organization that has developed the object-oriented middleware, right? So the registry stub is hard-coded, you could say, into the object-oriented middleware. Any node that can use the object-oriented middleware already has a registry stub that can be used to make remote calls to the registry. So now let's have a look at some important issues related to remote method invocation. The first is call by reference versus call by value. So first let's see what call by value means. The caller is calling some method at the callee node, let's call it met, which can take some object, an object of the class myClass for example, and does whatever handling of this MC object. So the caller now will do callee.met and pass an object. So the MC object of my class was created here on this line with a new call here, created that object, and now that object is being passed to the met method on the callee side. And the question is then, is this the same object somehow, or is it a copy of the object? With call by value, it is a copy of the object. And in that case, the class my class, if we are talking about Java or my, must implement Java IO serializable. So if we create an object of a class implementing serializable and hand that object to a callee using an RMI call, then a copy will be created on the receiving side. So now we have the object that was sent from the caller side, and we have the object that was received on the callee side, and they are two completely different objects. So what happens is that during the marshalling process, the MC object is serialized. And then it's deserialized during the unmarshalling process on the callee side. So then we have call by reference, and in this case the class of which an object is being sent must implement the remote interface, Java RMI remote, which means it is an object that can be exported to the object-oriented middleware and used as a stub called remotely. Now again the object is being passed to the method met, but now the object MC is, as we can see in this diagram, a remote object, meaning that MC that will be passed over the network is the stub of my class object, not a serialized version of my class object, meaning the callee will now have a reference back to the same object as the caller is referencing. So now, when my class implements remote, both the callee's reference and the caller's reference will be to the same object residing on the caller side. And that is because what was sent here was the stub of the my class object. So next, let's talk about threads. So a typical way that threads are handled by an OOM is that at the callee side, there is a thread pole in the object-oriented middleware, which means that each call from the callee side is assigned to a particular thread that then performs the call to the actual callee. Some handling is performed and the method returns and the thread is back in the thread pool. The next call will be assigned to another thread, or the same for that sake, executing and back again. So the server is inherently multi-threaded. The threading is handled by the object-oriented middleware, and we don't need to do anything in our code to make it multi-threaded. On the client side, on the other hand, there is often no multi-threading. Some code is executing here, and we make a call to the callee, call the method met, for example. Then it's the actual thread executing in the caller that executes the callee stub. So it's the same thread turning yellow here, but still the same thread performing the network call, and then that thread is blocked here until there is a return from the callee. And only then can that thread continue executing. So this means the client is not multi-threaded. We do not get the responsive user interface if it's the user interface thread that performs this call. And this is called synchronous communication. The alternative to synchronous calls is, as usual, asynchronous calls. And that means here that the thread executing the application code, the blue thread, returns as soon as the call to the remote method has been made. But the yellow call, the actual network call, is made by a thread internal to the object-oriented middleware. So the problem is what to do with return values from the remote method, since the calling thread already returned when the return value arrives. And even if the method is void, what to do if the method throws an exception? Okay, so how those situations can be handled is not included in this course. It's enough here to know that there is such thing as object-oriented middleware supporting asynchronous communication. However, it is not supported in Java RMI.